Yes. That is, generally those fights become more and more of a puzzle as you encounter more of them, because they'll have other various force fields in place, and it becomes harder to find two that are right next to each other that you can kill at once. But with enough practice and, well, letting them come back to life if you're, that bad at it, then you can usually figure it out who you've got to kill last. And as you can see, the original reason for us coming here, the scent trail, leads right into that hut where that guy was sitting at the window. So let's just hop right on in.
And because wolves are extremely heavy, we just break down the roof.
And let's turn our senses on for a decently long cutscene. Enjoy. And there we have Barnes the Bomb Maker, Renato the Village Shaman, and his daughter Luda. They're certainly all interesting characters. And one thing I've got to say that I noticed for the first time when I was recording this video, because I didn't really pay too much attention to the dialogue before. I kind of skimmed through it when I played the first time. But it mentioned Barnes was talking about the general store lady who got attacked by one of the shadow creatures, and it's heavily implied that she gets turned into one of them, which is just another layer of dark awfulness to just add on to this tale of kingdoms being taken over and people being turned into ghosts. It's a pretty interesting detail that, as far as I can remember, nothing really comes of it.
Yeah, it's actually, now that I think of it, so with Twilight Princess, I've had a lot of good and bad things to say about it. But kind of like how you mentioned, I remember picking up on that the first time I played through the game, but I don't really remember anything ever coming of it. So, generally I would say that's probably one of my biggest complaints with the game, is through a lot of different events, you will come up with something that's a very, very interesting idea, and something that you really haven't seen in Zelda before. And then, as soon as it's kind of mentioned, there's a little bit that deals with it, and then you kind of just wave a hand at it and it disappears, never to be seen again. I think you had mentioned at one point before, as an example, there's a couple dungeon items that, as soon as you get them, you never really use them again.
Yeah, that's similar to this train of thought. And it is rather interesting, the implication that not all of the fiends that you're attacking and killing were monsters to begin with. Like, these shadow keys were obviously keys to begin with, and well, who knows what these shadow insects are? But the Kargaroks were Kargaroks, the Bokoblin were Bokoblin, but some of them might have been normal Hylians too. But there's just nothing really that's done with it. Like, there's no difference, no indication whether you're attacking a monster or a former Hylian.
Right. And even then, later on, you'll kind of see an idea of what happens when one of those monsters actually becomes... Well, I'm not going to spoil it. I'll let that stand, because it's actually one of the cooler parts of the game. Although, the reveal of it's a little disappointing, in my opinion.
Yep. Well, they mentioned that the general store was now vacant, so let's check it out. Well, I can't really say first, because we checked out Renato's hut first. But let's check it out next. And as you can see, we've got our fifth Twilight Insect in here. So with that sorted, we'll move on to that hill that was behind the general store, and continue our search from there. And dodge that Shadow Kargaroks again.
That poor vacant general store. Something tells me we'll never see it again.
Yeah, it's not like stores have much importance in the Zelda series to begin with. Not really much to buy, just supplies and stuff. And here we have a little hotel type building. And a quick check of the senses reveals that there is an insect hiding in that oven. Well, the only thing that we can really do about it is to smoke that sucker out. So, light up the Barbie. Dinner's done.
Good, Link. Now burn the whole house down. Burn it all.
No, not yet. We've got business to take care of first.
Okay, stop all the insects, then burn the house down.
Right. It's nice that the voices in our heads are so reasonable at times like this.
Yeah.
But yeah, here you can see just how annoying it is that these guys are invincible when you knock them on their backs, because I was just sitting there for, you know, quite a couple seconds before I was able to finish off one of them. And here you can see me just not bothering to deal with it and charge attacking them. But one of the things about the charge attack is, unlike the spin attack, which you can pretty much just charge forever, and the only thing stopping you from, you know, holding the charge down is your frustration of not being able to go anywhere, you know, fast at all. The charge attack that Midna provides us with, we can't charge infinitely, and in fact, when we were coming into Eldin just after we tug under the gate, those two Bokoblins there, I was trying to get them both with one charge attack, but the charge time ran out, and I ended up just killing the one. So that is something that you want to keep in mind when you're facing the shadow beasts as well. Long story short. And here we have another house to explore. I'm not quite sure whose house it is, but it's probably not very important anyway.
Right. Now, what you kind of mentioned about the whole charge having a certain amount of time, I had a couple of thoughts on that, actually, now that I think a little more on it. And now, seeing as this isn't the case, I'm probably just going to let it go down to being Midna is lazy and doesn't want to hold it forever. But one of the things you could think about was, originally, this might have been a magic-heavy game. Which...
Yeah, I know that they planned to implement a magic meter in the beta, but they got rid of it.
Right.
And you have to dash into that window, otherwise you'll just bounce off of it.
Right, but it kind of indicative of the whole magic being in the beta. If you actually take the Wii box art for Twilight Princess and look at the back of it, there's a scene of one of the later dungeons where you're fighting, I believe it's one of the Darknuts. And if you look at it, you can actually see the magic meter in there. That or back then the lantern was green and the lantern was invisible or something.
I don't remember any room where you're fighting a Darknut that's dark anyway.
Right. But yeah. And one of the things it could have been is that charge attack could have initially abused your actual magic meter for one reason or another.
Well, that's probably it, you know, just like the spin attack. And also with this house, I keep forgetting that it's a tunnel and not a digging spot, and that you have to press forward on the control stick to go through it. But here we have another insect cooking time. But this time we're in Barnes's storage house.
Burn! Burn!
Now we've got no choice but to listen to the voices in our head that are telling us to get the hell out. You can be damaged by those explosions, so you can, you know, die in that house if you don't get out in time. But it's fairly simple to get out.
Now, was it just me, or did I notice something in there that Midna was talking about how romantic that scene felt?
Well, I guess it's like the whole Japanese men's romance adventure thing. I don't really think that she's talking about, you know, like, romance in the way that we would normally think about it, because that would imply that, you know, she's thinking more of Link than something just to use and abuse for her own benefit. And that's not really Midna-style thinking. But as you can tell there, when you grab a tier of light, it does refill your heart meter some. So that's not something that I had noticed before, because it never really came up. And also, be very careful with that Shadow Kargarok, as the platform that you're on is thin. But yes, so tiers of light do double as a healing item when you collect them.
It's something like either half a heart or a full heart with each one.
Yep. I collected those three a bit too quickly to be able to tell, you know, which one it was. And I only get half a heart damage here. So it's got to be at least half.
I'm going to guess it's a whole heart, just based on the healing property and equating it to a heart from...
Yeah, just a drop heart.
It's the MacGuffin heart.
Yep. But we've pretty thoroughly explored Kakariko Village, and we only have 13 tiers of light to our name. As you can see on the map here, there are three of them, which are in another area of this province. Unfortunately, we're running out of time. Oh, by the way, wolves ignore fall damage. Something to keep in mind. But anyway, we'll be exploring that area next time. So, until then, see ya later.
See ya.